Behold the voice of God.
For those of you who don't know me officially, my name is Amanda Waller.
And I am Aaron Mosh, host of Task Force X.
What, are we some kind of suicide squad?
Well, yeah, that and...
Checkmate.
Task Force X is a podcast that tells the stories of John Ostrander's Suicide Squad and Paul Kupperberg's Checkmate from the late 80s, early 90s.
I want to build a team of some bad people who can do some good.
And that's what Suicide Squad is. While Checkmate is a team of good people doing some good, my mission here is to chronicle each and every title in all the books that Suicide Squad and Checkmate appeared in during that era.
We're the U.S. government. You're going to start a blog and expose us?
Well, a blog and a headcast, Amanda.
Those scumbags are trying to screw me.
Not at all, Amanda. Just trying to help everyone else discover the joy of the Suicide Squad and Checkmate. Anywho, hope you guys have as much fun with these comics as I did when I first read them. Oh, so many years ago.
Mother...
That's enough of that, Amanda. Let's go ahead and start the show.
I didn't believe the stories.
Nobody does.
Remember, I'm watching.
I see everything.
And welcome back to Task Force X. I know it's been a bit of a hiatus. I apologize for that. Let's get on with the show, though. I'm not going to dilly-dally and worry about and over-apologize, but I probably will for the delay, but... Let's go and get started with this show. This episode, we've got two issues for you. Suicide Squad issue 48 and 49. So let's go and get started. So starting this month, we're going to look at issue 48 of Suicide Squad. From Mike's Amazing World of Comics, I am told this cover date was December of 1990, but the on sale date was a month earlier, November the 6th of 1990. The cover price was $1. The title of this was called In Control. As normal, the writers was the extraordinary John Ostrander and Kim Yell. Artist, Jeff Isherwood. Letter, Todd Klein. And colorist, Tom J. McCraw. The cover was done by the magnificent Steve Lytle. And let's talk about that cover. The cover has a picture of the Joker with a gun on Babs as Barbara's in a yellow jacket with pants. She's in her wheelchair and her jacket and shirt, I guess, is she got a pink shirt, it looks like, ripped open to see the bat costume underneath it. The Joker standing over her, one hand on her belly, the other with a gun to her head. And behind him, we can see, I believe it's supposed to be Oracle in the background, her computer persona. It's all in green, computer screen, green screen at the time. Beautiful cover. I know the Suicide Squad, the first Suicide Squad movie kind of, in quotes, focused on the Joker as the villain, as a villain of the movie. And a lot of people wanted to see more of the Joker in there. And I'm like, no, for one, that was a horrible Joker. Jared Leto did a horrible Joker, in my opinion. Also, the Joker's not a big part of the Suicide Squad. And when I think of the Joker, I think of this issue, which... As we read through it, we're going to find the Joker's not really in this issue. It's just Babs dealing with the repercussions of the Killing Joke when she got crippled. So that was, again, but again, I've talked about the Suicide Squad movie. We're not going to go into that right now. Maybe at some point here before the show ends, we'll look at the second Suicide Squad movie. I'll do another commentary on that one, but we're not talking about Suicide Squad the movie. We're talking about the comic book. So yeah, it's a great cover. This is when I think of Suicide Squad. And especially if I think of the Joker involvement in the Suicide Squad, this is the cover I think of. It's magnificent. I think Jeff Isherwood did a fantastic job showing, you know, Barbara's, not so much fear, but whatever it is with the Joker standing over her. Barbara's looking beautiful. Joker's looking menacing as always. It's classic Joker for this time. I love it. Great cover. But let's go ahead and get started on the story itself. So we start out with... Count Vertigo, who is in a straitjacket in a sealed room, letting loose of his powers. And we find out that apparently, I guess, kind of detoxing from being controlled by Vertigo, or by Vertigo, by being controlled by Poison Ivy previously. And before that, Heller from back earlier in the series. So he's kind of detoxing and trying to get control of himself after all this mind control stuff. Great shots of him, you know, Vertigo. He can, again, cause vertigo and cause people to, you know, lose control. And that's his powers. And so it's interesting seeing the way his power plays out in this room. He's in a straitjacket And we also get Amanda talking to Simon LaGreve, you know, thanking him for working with Vertigo and also bringing Mari back from Israel. Again, all wrapping up from the previous issues. I do like, you know, Amanda's kind of apologizing for not doing more for Simon LaGreve when he got shot previously. And he's like, you're in prison. What the hell could you do? And he's like, yeah, but still rub me raw. We haven't seen eye to eye, Simon. And I know we didn't part well last time I saw you, but I've always respected you. Simon's like, I like you too, Amanda. And since I've become the head of IMHS, I think a bit better of you. And he's like, you know, and we're kind of touching on when Amanda was put in jail in issue 40, when they did that year, issue 39, 40, we did that year skip when she was in jail. And he's like, well, why did you let him put you in jail? If you'd fought it, you might have beaten it. You'd beaten worse. But, you know, she gave in to steal without a fight. And again, and this is, again, going back to the Suicide Squad movie where, you know, she killed her support staff just because they were there and they knew too much. That's not Amanda. Amanda's not a villain. Yes, she does bad things, but for a right reason. But she wouldn't kill someone just to kill him. And this kind of, you know, here, she let herself go to prison because she realized she crossed the line. She knew it. She did it deliberately. And given the same situation, as she says, she would do the exact same thing again. So, and again, if she did it and got away with it, it would undermine everything she's supposed to be defining or defending. She had to pay a price, so she did. And again, like she says here, and like I've said about her, she's not pretending to be a saint. She took the first legitimate offer they gave her to get out and took it, but she was willing to serve her time. Because again, Amanda's not a bad guy. She's not, and again, some later books have portrayed her as kind of a bad guy, and the movies have kind of painted her as a bad guy. She's not a bad guy. She's had a difficult past, a difficult life, as we've talked about previously, and she's doing a difficult job. So does she lose her way sometimes? Yes. And that's why, again, the movies didn't portray this, but that's why she surrounds herself with good people to help out. Because, I mean, yes, in the movie they had Katana, who I've never been a big fan of, but they should have had Bronze Tiger. They should have had Mary. They should have had, or Mari. They should have had some other heroes in there to help her out. Because of the heroes, and maybe I guess that's an alternate universe where she didn't have a bunch of heroes, or quotes, heroes, to help keep her grounded and keep her doing the right thing. So I don't know. But again, I love this here. And I like this. Yeah, she's you know, going about how, you know, she said she would do it again. She took the deal and she shows that Steel would turn up eventually with a deal, but she was willing to do her time. She's like, if necessary, glad I didn't have to. And Simon's like, I'm glad you haven't gotten all noble. You owe me a favor. So I do like the change there that, or the, you know, the shift there, you know, he's like, well, yeah, why did you do this? And she explains, I'm glad that you aren't getting all noble on me, because basically I got something I need you to do. So I love this interaction. It's just two pages, basically. I'm not counting the splash page with Vertigo. So it's got two pages, basically, of them talking, and we're finding Amanda's true character, what I've always said about her in these pages. And she knows she's not always made the best choices, and she knows that she'll do it again. That's who she is, but she's not an outright villain. But enough ranting about that. Let's go and move on to the story. So again, as Simon mentioned, he's the head of IMHS, which is, if you read the Firestorm book at the time, also written by John Ostrander, and I believe it also showed up in the Spectre book written by John. This was I think it started off as a school project, or project from the colleges or something like that. It became its own thing, and this floated through all of John's books. As I've said, John had his own little interconnected continuity with all the books he wrote, and characters would switch back and forth between books. We saw, forget his name now, the Russian guy from Firestorm here a couple issues ago. We've got, you know, Simon going back and forth and mentioning the IMHS. And another character comes up. He brings out a portfolio on the Thinker too, which was Cliff Carmichael, who again started off as a Firestorm character. Cliff was he started off in the first issues of Firestorm in the same school with Ronnie, kind of the bully. Again, over in Firestorm, when it started off, it was kind of a Spider-Man take, but different. In Spider-Man, Peter Parker was the nerd and being bullied by the school jock. In the Firestorm book, Ronnie was the school jock being bullied by the nerd. So, because Cliff was very smart, very kind of hippie. He had mutton sideburn, mutton chops, or whatever they're called. Very, very 70s when he was created. So, but yeah, so Cliff eventually got the Thinker's helmet and became the Thinker too, became a bad guy. And so he's showing up over here in Suicide Squad. Because again, that's what John did. He passed his characters around the books he wrote, which I loved. I like it on the larger scale also when the invasion's happening and other books just happen to mention it because it's something going on. But I do love that John had his own little inner continuity where he could pass characters and use characters from other books in different books. So I like that, the way John did that. I thought he did a great job. And so we get some backstory on Cliff and the Thinker. Apparently they gave him the Thinker helmet to analyze. So he used the helmet to analyze the helmet. And we find out that he actually was able to reduce everything down to microchips, which he implanted into his brain. And he had a serial port pet in his neck, so he could directly interface with any computer. And we also find out that he can control another person's brain if he's within about maybe 6 feet of him or so. And as Amanda says, you know, they're describing Cliff, and this file says that he was has psychological problems, like maybe he's a sociopath. And so Amanda sums it up. She's like, so you're telling me we now have a new Thinker, better than the first, who is also a sociopath with no sense of right or wrong. And that's when Simon says, you know, he can also control another person's brain within about 6 feet of him. And she's like, let me guess, he's loose, isn't he? Yes. And you want the squad to go after him. Why not use your own group, the, what's it called, Captains of Industry? And he informs Amanda that Cliff is after Oracle. And the Captain Industries are a group of heroes, in quotes, that appeared over the Firestorm book at this time, again, by John. So, again, I do like that, you know, John does, or Firestorm, who Cliff started out as an adversary of, I mean, they have their own team over there, but we find out that, you know, the reason he's going to Amanda is because that Cliff is going after one of hers. So, of course, Amanda takes that personally, so. And then we cut to Gotham City, where we have Cliff. Again, Cliff is an interesting character. He's got glasses. He's got a, I believe that's a mullet, short on top. What is it? Party in the back, business in front, or vice versa. Business in the front, party in the back. That's what it is. He's got a buzz on top almost and long hair in the back, which again, I guess if Amanda telling us that he's a sociopath didn't work, looking at him, you can tell he's a sociopath. Anyone that rocks a haircut like that. But yeah, so he's walking in Gotham and these gangbangers come up and they're like, give me your coat, homeboy, and watch your wallet too. Maybe we'll let you get here alive. And like Cliff's like, shouldn't you scare me first? Over here, take out their knives. Threaten me. Make me quake in my boots. And so they're pulling their knives out and, you know, flipping them around. He's like, good, good. Now, show me how little life means to you. Won't you stick your knives in the throat of the guy on your right? And then we cut away when you see Cliff smiling as laughing as we hear, we see blood squirting all over as these guys are killing themselves. So again, this shows you how powerful Cliff is. He's got these gangbangers who's about to rob and more likely kill him. He had them kill themselves, so, or kill each other, I guess, is a better word for that. So again, I do like the panel here. Again, and then after the, so this panel has 6 panels on it. The 5th panel, there's a close-up of Cliff's face, his blood squirting around, a little bit gets on his glasses. We don't see the guys killing themselves or killing each other, but we see the blood squirting onto Cliff. And then we cut away and we see, you know, 5-6 bodies laying on the ground as Cliff walks away. Now, where is that next address? Because he's trying to find Oracle. He found out that she has a bunch of different aliases and safe houses. And whenever she orders anything, she has it sent to different addresses and blind drops and other people's houses, and then picks things up to make it harder to track down who she really is, which is smart. It's just unfortunately, Cliff is smart enough to work out the details and hunt her down. And then we get Simon talking to Amanda Still, and he's telling her that apparently they set up a virus that would wipe his chips, give him a chance to neutralize them. And since since Cliff had these chips implanted in his brain, he's literally it's a computer that the speed of thought. So that's how Cliff's able to track her back, because they tried to implant this virus into him. But since he's got these chips in his brain and, you know, the product can process as fast as a human can think, he was able to take control of this virus and use it to start backtracking Oracle to where it came from. And so Amanda's like, well, you know, we need to start from the beginning. Do you still have the old Thinker's helmet? So again, we can tell, you know, she's going to try to use the old Thinker's helmet to find Cliff, the new Thinker, Thinker 2. And then we cut to Barbara Gordon running down a hall in a house. She's kind of narrating that she's in her house again, running down the long stretch of corridors. And she has to open the door before her dad does. And again, it's kind of flashing back to when the Joker shot her back in The Killing Joke. Again, she opens the door and she sees her dad standing there with a gun. It changes to Batman holding a gun on her. It changes to Batgirl before we finally end up on the Joker in his Hawaiian outfit, the camera around his neck. The classic Killing Joke image. Standing there, but it's a close-up of it with him holding a gun on her here on page 7. It's a nice, I like the way this, and we can tell it's a nightmare because she's already crippled, she's already been shot, so she's kind of reliving it with her own fears and blame and whatever else you want to call it, working on it. So, but yeah, it's a nice way the panel's laid out. Like I say, she's her dad, because she kind of blames her dad a little bit. She blames Batman, she blames herself, and of course, she blames the Joker. So again, she's flashing through each of these. So it's a nice page here on page 7, the way these panels are laid out. And it's kind of off kilter a little bit. It's got a black border around it, letting us know that we're in a dream. And we get close up with the gun as it goes blam. We see Barbara flying back. Joker hits her, beats on her a little bit, starts to rip her clothes off. And then we see him taking pictures. And she says he strips her naked. He starts taking pictures. And he's like, nothing personal, my dear. This is really all for the Batman's benefit. Smile. As he laughs. So, again, Barbara's just having nightmares about when she got crippled and the Joker, what he did to her. So, and then we come out and find out it's not actually a dream, but it's she's talking to her therapist, or psychologist, whatever it is about it. And she says, you know, for 6 months, all she had was pain. That had built a bridge between sections of her spine so she could sit up straight. And she'll never, never, never walk again. Cut to the current continuity where she's actually walking again. Apparently, she was still shot in current continuity, but they used some chips or something and be able to make her get better. But at this point, she said she could never walk again. And so basically, it's just her talking with her therapist, which, again, one thing John does really well, as I've mentioned before, he can, again, Barbara Gordon's not this, but he can take these second and third string characters and can give them life, can give them, make you feel for them. So, and that's kind of what he's doing here. He's giving us some backstory on Barbara, in case you're not familiar with her, and giving us some of what she's been going through, because she hasn't in quotes, starred in a book. She appeared as Oracle over in Batman book. She's appeared as Oracle over here and as Barbara. But we don't get a lot of her thoughts and motivation and all that. So again, we do get some nice storytelling here of John and Kim. Again, I don't know which one wrote this. Part of me leans maybe towards Kim since we're getting a woman's perspective. And Kim as a woman had a better shot or a better... ability to write from a woman's perspective. And we're getting, you know, like I said, when we were talking about the dream sequence, that, you know, she kind of blames Batman for it. She blames her dad a little bit, but she also blames herself mostly. She should have known better to just open the door without looking. Because again, her dad's the police commissioner. It's something that, you know, should have been drilled into her at an early age, you know, to make sure, watch before she's open a door. And also the fact that she was Batgirl. And again, she's telling the psychologist, you know, she should have known better to look without opening. And her psychologist's like, why? Why should you have known better? And we get a moment of silence there. Because again, the psychologist doesn't know that Barbara used to be Batgirl. And she's keeping that. And again, I've always said, you know, no matter what you do, you have to be honest with your preacher, your doctor, and your lawyer. Your psychologist also fits in there because, again, they can't help you. They don't know everything. So, again, her doctor here knows that Barbara's leaving something out. She just doesn't know what it is and why. And, again, Barbara doesn't want to tell her because of, you know, of being Batgirl. And she's afraid, you know, if people find out she was Batgirl, they can draw conclusions and maybe find out who Batman is. Or maybe they go after her dad for things that she did as a superhero. So she's very careful still, even though she's no longer a hero. She's very careful about letting out that she used to be Batgirl. And that's what she says here. She's like, I'm sorry, Dr. Miller, I'm telling you everything I can, but some secrets aren't just mine. And Doctor says, well, you have the right to be happy, and no one has the right to deny you that. And Barbara leaves on that note. And I like this here on bottom of page 10, as Barbara's leaving, we see a, again, I believe it's a surprint of Batgirl walking next to her. And again, we get here, she kind of sums up what I was saying just a moment ago, that, you know, she tells her she can't tell her that she's a Batgirl, and that's why she should have known better than to answer the door like that. And she says she can't be Batgirl anymore, she can't walk again, have kids, probably marry. Someday she's called the stupid elevator she's having problems with because it's a little too high. Again, this is before there was a lot of these laws in place to help people in wheelchairs and the crippled and stuff. So she squeezes into this full elevator in her wheelchair. And again, as she's going, she's thinking this entire time about what's going on in her life and how, you know, Cliff's trying to track her down. She talks about how she wanted to be a superhero, so she created the computer version, called herself Oracle. And she's kind of just, again, a lot of guilt about what's going on. But guilt for getting shot, guilt for Cliff hunting her down. So I do like the fact that we're getting this insight into Barbara's mind. And yes, well, as her doctor said, she can't blame herself for everything. Again, because she was trying to do the right thing as Oracle. She had given up Batgirl by the time the Joker appeared and shot her. She'd retired shortly before that. And she wasn't shot for being Batgirl. She was shot because her dad's Commissioner Gordon and is friends with Batman. As he was saying in the flashback that, you know, nothing personal, it's a way to get to Batman's goat. And then we go back to IMHS where Amanda was talking to Simon and they bring out the Thinker's helmets. And again, Simon's like, here's the helmet, but I don't think wearing the Thinker's old helmet's a very good idea. Because again, Flag wore it back when they went to South America. And as he says, he was the only squad member to come back. And if Carmichael wasn't a sociopath before he put that thing on, he was afterwards. But again, from the Firestorm book, I think Cliff was a sociopath before that. So, or at least heading that way. So, but as we talked about Amanda, she's not a villain. She's not a sociopath, but she does have some moral issues. She does have some problems staying on the straight and narrow because of her life. So this helmet could push her over the edge. And that's what Simon's worried about. But as she said previously, she'll do what she needs to get the job done. So she's willing to put the helmet on, even if it does cost her sanity or whatever it may do, if it'll help him catch Cliff, especially before he gets to Barbara. So I do like here on bottom of page 12, where she's putting the helmet on and she's got the helmet up over her head. She's like, there's only one way of doing that, Simon. I have to climb into this section of hell with him and hope I can find my way back out. And so we cut into a computer simulation and we see, I believe it's supposed to be Amanda, computerized, attacking a computerized version of Cliff. I'm assuming this is Amanda. This avatar is much skinnier than Amanda is because, again, Amanda's a larger woman. But we see her, you know, she's in pink. Cliff is in like a reddish orange computerized version. She leaps with him a sword. And again, it's a couple pages of them fighting on a digital landscape. And again, for 1990, 1991, I mean, this was kind of their thinking of it. I'm sure if this story was written today, it would be more of a Ready Player One situation where it'd be more of a realistic and bigger, more dynamic, you know, things from other properties or other characters appearing in here, more realistic in quotes, if you will. So, but at the time, it was fantastic the way they drew this battle between the two. And there's no words on it, just them hunting each other down, sending energy beams at one another with their swords. And I'm not quite, again, with no words or no dialogue or no information bubbles, it's hard to tell. I'm not quite sure what happened here, but this last page, we show them facing off. And one of the building that one of them is in, I believe, it's a block building with like a red diamond on the top. The diamond explodes and we see Cliff kind of being thrown backwards. And Amanda's taking the helmet off. Hell! And okay, so I guess that wasn't Barbara. That wasn't Amanda. I guess she was watching Cliff and Barbara going at it. And so she's explaining here what we just saw in the previous couple pages that, you know, Carmichael's upset the trap Oracle set and he's trying to bring her down. And apparently he knows that Oracle is a she. And we find out, you know, that she used a series of switches and networks and random access to cover her trail. And again, so she knows that Cliff is tracking her down by tracking the equipment and the supplies that she buys. So he's got to listen. And again, we get kind of a, what I talked about here earlier a little bit. We get Amanda telling us, you know, he tracked down her supplies, which found the manufacturers, got into their system, found out where they shipped the stuff, and he's tracking it back to where it originally ends up to. And again, he may end up killing her and anyone close to her. And I like as they're talking, Simon says, okay, it's fine, but first I want you to give me the Thinker's helmet. She kind of rips it away from him. No, I'm not quite done with the helmet's usefulness. I like it. No, I'll keep it with me, Simon. I've got a lot of uses for it. And Amanda's saying this, she's sweating, just like buckets off of her. She's saying this. And Simon's like, I'll accept that if you answer one more question for me, Amanda. Was that you or the helmet speaking? And I like this here on bottom of page 18, just this close up of Amanda's face, sweat just pouring off of her. And she holds the helmet in front of her. As Simon's behind her, you know, asking this question, was it you speaking or is it the helmet speaking? Who's using who? And next page, we see Amanda. She's getting a close-up of her face, holding the helmet, and just rage in her eyes. She's like, I'm in charge here. I am in charge here. And this last page here, the last half of the page on page 19, oh, it's broken into five panels as she picks the helmet up and just bangs it on the counter, breaking it. And as she picks the broken pieces up, she looks at it. She's like, huh, well, I've done more intelligent things in my life. And Amanda's like, you may never have done a better thing, Amanda. And so she gets a piece of paper and she writes down the addresses that she picked up while she was using the helmet before she forgets it. And so she says she wants to find Ben, Boomer Butt, and Deadshot because they have covered a lot of ground. So again, they're trying to find out where Cliff's at so they can stop him before he gets to Babs. And then we cut to an epilogue. Elsewhere, we're at a cabin with a Jeep out front, a family outside, boys on a swing. The mailbox out front says Kane. And we see at the bottom of page 20, we see a hand come out of the trees, a white hand grabbing some trees, moving it out of the way. And we see this little boy swinging on this tree swing as this white hand reach out and grabs him. And the boy's mom's like, Ricky! I'm assuming it's his dad. Ricky, what? Oh my God! And we see the guy in white pants, very very skinny, a white mohawk, white skin, grabbing the boy as the man runs back out to him with the shovel. And he's like, call the general, and whaps this ghoul, I guess, on the back of the head. And the ghoul just trounces on, knocks the dad down. And yeah, the kid's like, Daddy. And we see the woman on the phone. She's like, give me General Stewart. General J.E.B. Stewart. Tell him it's Marge Kane. Tell him they've taken my baby. They've taken his godson. Dun, dun, dun. Next, out of control. Again, great issue. Again, I'm doing this as two because it's a two-part story, basically, with some tie-ins to other things. But I love the start of this little storyline of the Thinker 2 versus Oracle, as I'm going to call it. In fact, that's going to probably be the name of this episode. But yeah, I do like, I say we get a little epilogue. We don't know who this Marge and her family is yet, other than related to, well, not related per se, but the godson of Jeb Stuart. Again, if you're an old-time DC reader, you know that Jeb Stuart was he had a haunted tank. It was Jeb Stuart and the Haunted Tank or something like that, like an old military war comic. So, again, it's not really tied into the Suicide Squad, but this is tying it in. So we're going to have to wait and see if this comes in next issue or if this is a future development. But great issue. Great first issue of this. So we're going to go ahead and jump into the second issue of this. This is issue 49. Again, cover date was January of 1991. The on-sale date, December the 4th, 1990. The cover price was $1. The title, as I just mentioned, Out of Control. Writer, once again, was John Ostender and Kim Yell. Pencilers, Luke McDonald. Inker, Jeff Isherwood. Letter, Todd Klein. Colorist, Tom McGraw. And cover was Norm Breyfogle. So I like Luke McDonald, who is the Suicide Squad penciler, is back on duty with Jeff just doing the inking this time. We get Norm Breyfogle, who's a big famous artist. He was a big Batman artist at the time. Fantastic. And both of these issues were edited by Dan Raspler, and they were both reprinted in the Suicide Squad, the Phoenix Gambit trade paperback, which came out in 2017. So that is the information on this issue. Now, let's get started on Suicide Squad number 49. So this issue, the cover, we get a close-up of Babs, in her wheelchair. We get the bat signal behind her with some dynamic motion lines behind that. She's got a big-ass gun in her hand, and she's got a very frowny, upset face going, smile. And she's got a gun with a handgun with a sight on it, with a scope. Very menacing-looking gun, very large. It's a humongous gun, long. And again, this is another cover when I think of Suicide Squad and Babs in her time as Oracle. I think of this, again, the two-issue run. And just the way that she's extremely pissed off and she's ready to not take any BS from anybody. So it's fantastic. And this time the story starts out with Amanda sitting around with Simon, Ben Turner, a.k.a. Bronze Tiger, Floyd Lawton, a.k.a. Deadshot, and Digger Harkness, a.k.a. Boomerang or Boomerbutt. And she's kind of briefing them on the upcoming mission. Like, she's like, you're going to like this mission. No Balkan intrigues, no Middle East flare-ups, no passports, immunization shots, red shadows, lost luggage, or setting at computers starting World War III. We just find this creep by the name of Cliff Carmichael. You remember the old rogue meta character who called himself the Thinker? And again, the Thinker, I don't think they mention it in here, but if I'm not mistaken, he died back during the Suicide Squad Doom Patrol special, which I covered back in the day. And so I like, we get the team sitting around looking at portfolios, I guess, of Cliff. They've all got a picture of Cliff they're looking at. And again, we get kind of a, Ben kind of here recaps, you know, he's the guy with the thinking helmet, amplified his intellect long before computers existed. He used to fight the original Flash and things like that. Yeah, he died on the disastrous mission in South America, the one where Flag walked away from, that you never talk about. Which, again, if I'm not mistaken, yeah, that is the Suicide Squad / Doom Patrol crossover book, which, yeah, the team lived up to its name. Everyone on that mission died. Hawk showed up over there. Good story. I like that one still. And so basically, we get kind of a recap of what we found out last issue. And I like, as they're talking, Amanda's telling me, you know, that he used the first helmet to reconfigure the technology, blah, blah, blah. He implanted into his, you know, by some scientists. And Ben's like, that was stupid. How do you get them to do that? And we, again, as they mentioned, within 10 feet of Mark Carmichael, you're in a psi field where you can pretty much control your mind. And so Adam saw a port in the back of his neck so he can plug directly in. We talked about all this. Again, they call him a cyberpunk. Again, this is when cyberpunk was coming out to be a big thing. And, oh, yeah. He'd been diagnosed as a sociopath. And Boomerang's in here, bleeding lovely. Simple mission, she calls it. Piece of bloody cake. No walkus? Out of there be playing footsie with a bleeding cobra. No bloody way I'm doing this, you great cow. Again, I love how brave and tough Boomerang is in his head. But when it comes down to it, he's a bit of a coward. He won't face off against Amanda because she knows that he'll kick his butt if it comes down to it. Which, again, was one of my problems with Boomerang in the Suicide Squad movie. But we're not going to get into that again. And so Amanda starts handing out lists. She kind of recaps that Vixen Virgo's down. Ivy's AWOL. Ravon's dead. They're kind of shorthanded. So they're all going to take lists looking for Carmichael, including her. And she hands one to Boomerang. She's like, including you two down under. And again, as I said, while he is a bit of a coward, he does let his voice out once in a while. And he's like, stuff it. This is too much like bloody work. Give it to police, eh? I won't do it. As he throws the list down, Amanda's like, fine, you're fired. Go and get a real job. And Boomerang's like, oh, well, come on. I'm just joking around a bit. I'm just teasing. Come on. And she's like, I'm not. I am running this show, and you can do as I say, or you get the hell out of here, Harkness. You read me? Right, you're right. Whatever you say, you bet. No, doing us like a bleeding joke anymore. Jeez. It's like, Boomerang's like, I ain't doing it. Well, fine, get out of here. You're fired. Oh, wait, no, come on. Let me stay around. Come on. And again, Ben's like, what do we do if you find this piece of work? Nail him? No. That mind control power of his calls for some coordination. Report in and wait for instructions. And Deadshot, of course, as they say, if you're a hammer, everything looks like a nail. She's like, why don't we just shoot him? Because I want you to kill him. Do nothing unless he tries to kill you. To stop him, I may have to kill him. Not you. You could just kneecap him. That's true. She's like, you could get away without killing if you wanted to. It's you are. Yeah, you're right. But even if he kneecapped him, I don't know if that, it depends on if the pain is enough to stop him from using his mind control powers, I guess is the proper question. And again, as they're leaving, Deadshot's like, the airline's find my missing luggage yet? Not yet. Just spotted in Anarcha? But then they lost track of it again. And Deadshot, Floyd looks over at Captain Boomerang's like, bang, with his finger gun. And Boomerang's like, maybe it's time to find a way to kill me old mate Lawton before me old mate Lawton kills me. As Floyd's walking away, Deadshot's walking away, Boomerang's, you know, thanking him, hey, I need to kill him off because he's going to kill me if I don't watch it. And Ben's asking about Mary's condition or Mari's condition. And she's like, do I look like her doctor? You think I've memorized her chart? You're so darn curious. Why don't you go look on the firm and find out yourself? And as he leaves, Simon looks over at Amanda. He's like, the squad is less healthy mentally, it would seem, than I remember. Like Amanda's like, Harkness is Harkness. A certain percentage of Lawton is just an act. And Ben isn't as bad as he wants us to think. And he's like, and you? Same as ever was, doctor. And he's like, pity. Because again, as I said, Amanda's had a hard life and she's gone through some crap. So she's doing, I would say, remarkably well for what she's went through. But what do I know? And again, he mentions that during their debrief, she didn't mention Oracle to the group. And she tells them, well, they don't need to know that or the mission's a freebie. She's like, I've got a secret I've kept even from you, Simon. So the team doesn't, you know, because again, at this point, the team's a team for hire, where previously they were working for the government to get out of jail. Now they've kind of changed there a little bit after the whole Janus directive. And Amanda got out of jail. Actually, I guess it's all tied together. And Amanda went to jail and got out. Now they hire themselves out and they do missions that no one else can or wants to do. So again, Amanda's got a secret. She opens her purse and the new Adam jumps out. And again, as I've always said, I guess I say it mainly over my Head Speaks podcast where I'm covering the Power of the Atom that takes place before this. So if you're listening to both of my shows, spoilers, this is, may mention things. Well, as we talked about at the beginning of this run where this Atom showed up, Ray Palmer was killed in an explosion. This guy showed up to take his place, who may or may not be Ray. Doesn't look like Ray. Doesn't act so much like Ray from what we've seen, but we'll cover more of that later on in the series. So Amanda says that, you know, he's going to stay here in case Oracle checks in again. And that way he can jump through the phone line and land where she's at. And as Amanda's leaving, Simon's like, but I thought the Atom was dead. Oh, that was Ray Palmer, the old Atom. And so we find out that this is Adam Cray, the new Atom. And again, Cray, I don't think they've mentioned it yet. There was a senator from a while back with the last name of Cray. So maybe there's a relationship. We'll see. I think this is the first time they mentioned that his name's Adam Cray. Up until now, it's just been the Atom. And it looks like it's been kind of hemming and hawing and trying to keep it mysterious whether Ray actually died or if this is Ray. So we find out that this is actually Adam Cray, the new Atom. So again, I like Ray, but I think Adam Cray does a good job as Adam Cray, the new Atom. And so we cut to Cliff Carmichael, again, in some building where this guy got some computer equipment delivered there. He's like, what if I do? What business of yours? And again, he's using his ability, his power, whatever you want to call it, to get the guy to do what he wants. And he says he gets paid just to have as a drop-off point. And then someone calls and tells him where to send the stuff. He says the machine is like, the voice is a machine like you hear on the checkout line reading off the prices. And so the guy, Stanley, tells Cliff, you know, where he gets the stuff delivered to. Apparently goes to different places. Last time went to an Amy Bedos at a hotel somewhere on Hudson Street. And meanwhile, while Stanley, this guy is talking to Cliff, his wife's in the background yelling, Stanley, who's at the door? Stanley, what's going on? Because this old woman ironing, she got iron on the iron board. She's like, Stan, you think I just talked to hear myself talk? Who is at the door with you? And Cliff's like, you know, Stan, your wife's a cow. She makes you crazy, too. I know. Why don't you do us all a favor and kill her? Strangle her right now. Okay. And so he goes walking towards his wife. She's like, Stanley, what are you doing? Stanley, stop it. You're scaring me. Stanley. And Stanley just chokes the living crap out of his wife. And so, you know, Cliff gets this guy to kill his wife after he got the information he needs. And then we cut to the police headquarters in Gotham, the police department shooting range, where we have Barbara shooting at some targets. And again, she's talking about how she hates guns. She's trying to figure out what she's doing, but she knows she needs to protect herself. She needs to be able to kill somebody, even though she's not a huge gun fan, gun person. She knows that guns sometimes are a necessity and that she needs to be able to prepare to defend herself if it comes down to it. And again, like here on page 9, she's kind of flashing back to the Joker shooting her. Because again, if she would have had a gun at the time, maybe she could have shot the Joker first. Probably not, because he kind of surprised her. And again, she wasn't thinking about anyone attacking her, so she wasn't prepared. But so anyway, so it's basically getting some more thoughts about her and practicing with her gun, getting ready to defend herself if need be, and kind of flashing back to the Joker. And as she's shooting here on page 10, she's shooting a picture of the Joker and then of Carmichael running out with her knife. Again, she's imagining, it's just a regular paper target with a silhouette, but she's imagining the Joker and Carmichael attacking her. And as she says, you know, she kind of going over the whole anti-gun, pro-gun thing that, you know, that there's not much she can do. She could tell her dad, but that'd be the end of Oracle, because again, he would find out and he'd try to put a stop to that. And she's like, well, the real question is, you know, can I kill him? Can I physically make myself do it? I won't be a victim again, but does that mean I must become a killer? It flies in the face of everything I was taught, everything I believe. But perhaps everything I was taught to believe was wrong. Don't we have the right to defend ourselves? So again, she's kind of debating the anti-gun and pro-gun approach of, you know, that yes, she has the right to defend herself, but she believes that all life is sacred and she shouldn't take someone's life. But if it's a her or someone else, she knows what needs to be done. And then so she's thinking that. She sees the target flashing between the Joker and Carmichael. The next page, the very top, just a little, small little box, has her just blasting away at the paper. Bunch of holes straight out, just a straight line down like she's cutting him in half. Fantastic. And then we cut over to Boomerang. Again, he's looking at these different apartments. And again, he's always complaining. He's like, bloody cow. Sticks me blowing in the middle of the bloody ghetto and tells me to go looking for another piece of white bread. Saw this. I'm off. Hoping a bar till I couldn't find this bloody thing. And again, so as Boomerang's walking through this ghetto, as he calls it, these guys come by. Hey, man, you're the wrong neighborhood. This is our neighborhood. You have to pay a hefty toll. Like, blood off. I'm looking for someone. And one of the guys like, you found us. Give me a wallet. He's like, I'll give you something, all right. He pulls out a handful of Boomerangs, just tosses them. And they come around and knock out these guys out. And he's like, as he knocks them out, he's like, now kick back, pop a fuzzy, and wander back to my, put my abysmal failure to the wall. That's right, hey, mate, too bad. So again, Boomerang always looking out for Boomerang and always looking for an easy way out. So fantastic. Very much Captain Boomerang. And then we got to the Hotel Tamarindo, where Barbara's on the phone with her dad. No, I'm okay. The conference will be over there, so they'll be home. Again, so she thinks his dad, her dad, Commissioner Gordon, thinks she's out at a conference. Meanwhile, she's hiding out, trying to get the drop on Cliff before he gets her. And again, she says, you know, it's always been easy to lie to him because he trusts her. And there's some things better off. He's better off not knowing. And I guess all kids feel that way at some point. There's some things they think it's better off their parents not actually knowing. And so again, she's here under the guise of Amy Beddoes. She's trying to lure, as I said, lure Carmichael in to kill him. And again, as she says here, you know, why not? Isn't that what society tells us to do? Get a gun, defend yourself. And that's not the real question of it. The real question is, can I kill him? Can I physically make myself do it? Babs, you better decide that before. And then all of a sudden, Carmichael busts in. Hello, Amy. So yeah, I do like that Barbara is debating back and forth whether or not she should and whether she can kill Carmichael. And again, I'm not saying, I'm kind of the same attitude as Barbara. I don't think we need to kill everybody. I believe there is a use for guns, but I think people rely on them too much and too quickly. So I do like this debate she's having with herself on whether or not she should do it and if she can do it. So very nice. It's very thought-provoking. And then we cut over to somewhere else where we see a cop car following Lawton, who's walking down the street, and apparently they see him, and they say the New Orleans cops wants him for questioning. And the other cop's like, I don't know, Mike. Should we get some sort of backup? This guy's dangerous. Well, you want to share the spotlight? Look, he's in that alley. Go, go. Don't lose him. And the cops turn down the alley where Floyd's at. And as they jump out of the car, they run to the building he went into that was locked. And as they start to turn away, Floyd pops up. He's like, drop him. Then kick him away. Hands behind your head. And he shoots the cop's car to disable it. He says, I'm busy. I got work to do. Don't annoy me anymore. And just leaves the cops, which for them is a good thing. Because, you know, Floyd could have and normally would kill them. And after Floyd leaves, like, one of the cops is like, what do we do now, George? We sound like there's about half an hour. Then we find a phone. We call it in. We see we got attacked by a gang of snipers. And maybe both collect our pensions someday. Got it. So again, I guess they don't want to report that they met Deadshot and a Deadshot. I mean, I don't think that there's any shame personally. Again, I'm not a cop, so I can't speak for certain. But and yes, there's always a shame to get the drop pulled on you. But when you're dealing with someone that takes on Batman on a regular basis, or I guess not regular, but semi-regular basis, and other superheroes, you're not doing too bad. You escaped with your lives, so that's a good thing. But they figure it's easier, you know, say they were attacked by snipers, and, you know, maybe one day they can collect their pensions. And as they're doing that, we cut to the hotel where Cliff is questioning Amy, trying to find out what Oracle, how she knows Oracle, trying to find out who Oracle is. And she's like, what? So you say Oracle picks up the shipments from here, but you've never actually seen her? She's like, well, no, she has an extra key. I'm supposed to be out when she comes. And in fact, she's on her way over. I just talked to her before you came in. And Cliff's like, why don't I believe you, Amy? As he pushes her back on the chair tips over. And he's like, look at this room. It's there for someone who walks. Is this a wheelchair or a ruse, Amy? Are you playing games with me, Amy? Trip open your mind and find out, Amy. And as he's kind of taunting Babs, Amy, he appears behind him. So there you are, you nasty boy, you. We have Amanda standing there, arms. Again, this is the Amanda I love. She's willing to stand up to the Batman. She's willing to take on this psychopath that can control minds and tap into computers. She don't care. She's there in her suit or whatever, her jacket and a pants and a shirt. Oh, it's a suit necessarily, but she's there, you know, decked out. And she's like, you know what? Here I am, big boy. And Cliff's like, I know you. You're Amanda Waller. I heard about you in the papers about a year or so back. But you couldn't be Oracle, or could you? And as he's confronting Amanda, Babs is crawling over to try to get the gun. And Cliff's like, you don't really want to use that gun now, do you, Amy? Hope she shoots him just the way he says, Amy. Oh, and he's all, you know, you're a convicted felon, Amanda. You might call you Amanda, right? Anyway, Amanda, you killed some folks. So you're experienced at it. And you wouldn't mind doing me a little favor there and killing this crip for me, would you? Of course, then you can kill yourself. That way, no matter which of you is Oracle, it'll all be taken care of. Say goodbye, Amy. And so again, he's trying to get Amanda, using his powers, make her kill Barbara. Not knowing which one's Oracle, no matter who you are, at least I'm sure I'll get Oracle by killing you both. He's like, what are you doing? I need to tell you to look at me. Go kill the crip. And Amanda just punches him. She knocks him to the... No, it doesn't knock him out. She, you know, bloodies his nose. And he's like, hey, what do you have to do what I tell you? Why aren't you doing what I tell you? And she's like, I was wearing my thinking cap when I started to track you. It told me that I had what to do to jam your field. It don't work with me, you snotty little punk. And she just slams in the wall and just starts beating the crap out of Carmichael. And she slaps him around, bangs him into the table. And as she's beating the crap out of him, Barbara gets the gun. She's like, stand away from him, Mrs. Waller. And she's holding the gun on both Barbara. I'm sorry. Barbara's holding the gun on both Amanda and Cliff as Amanda's about to beat the snot out of him. And Cliff's like, hey, yeah, good girl, Amy. Didn't even have to tell you. Hey, you got to focus. You can't. And she's like, you can't do it, girl. She's like, I've got to. He's a sociopath. He wants to kill me and my friends and my family. And again, Amanda is very... intelligent. That's not what I'm going for. She's very, for being who she is, she's very empathetic, and she knows people. She can read people. That's what I'm trying to get to. And so she's like, you know, who are you really trying to kill? Because again, she can see on Barbara's face, and she's talked with Oracle, so she knows a little bit about what's going on. I'm not sure how much she knows, but she knows a little bit. And next page again, we see the Joker, her shooting the Joker, Batman, her dad, Batgirl, and. So again, she's got all this rage and frustration with what the Joker did to her. She kind of blames her dad. She kind of blames Batman. She blames herself. And so she sees herself shooting all these different people that she blames for her position. And she's like, no one. Take this, please, Miss Waller. And so she kind of gives up the ghost and is willing to try to give the gun to Amanda as Cliff jumps for it. Amanda gets to it first. And I like here on about top of page 21, where Amanda gets the gun, just cracks Carmichael upside the head. And so again, we find out, you know, Barbara asks how Amanda knew where to go. And she's like, well, Carmichael's left a buddy trail, but he also left one person alive at his last stop. I got there just after he left and got the address where Carmichael was going. So again, he should have had Stanley kill himself also after he killed his wife. But he left him alive. And so Stanley was able to tell Amanda where Carmichael was headed to next. We should probably all get out of here. The cops will gotten there by now, got the same address. And I assume you don't want to meet them. He's like, no, they can have the thinker, though. And again, she's like, why? He'll just plead crazy, go to Arkham Asylum. I think a more constructive use to make of our thinker. Also, I've got an offer to make you. You got to think about privacy. Fine, I won't pry. But I think we can help each other if you're willing to listen. And she's like, you saved my life and helped me from taking a life. All right, Ms. Waller, I'll listen. So again, we end up, Amanda's got a new prisoner, in quotes, to use. Someone to use on her for her missions if she needs to. And apparently she's going to offer some sort of deal to Barbara, which we'll find out about, not this issue, but we'll find out later, apparently. But Barbara's willing to listen to it. And we end back at the Institute for Metahuman Studies, which is IMHS, as we've talked about previously. And we get General Stewart here. And again, he's like, I'm sorry, General Stewart. I don't know where you got the idea that Amanda Waller was here. But as you can see, she certainly isn't. Dr. LaGreve, let's not play games. I know Amanda Waller was here. My sources are very good. Mary McCabe and Werner Vertigo are both here. So just tell me, please, when will Amanda Waller be back? Honestly, I don't know, General. Perhaps you could be more open with me. I could help you. Simon, I'm not an enemy. I helped Amanda take charge of the squad originally. Remember, I need the squad now. A mission? Are you here in official capacity, General? No, Simon, a personal one. It involves a debt of honor to someone who died, a debt that she and I and all the squad owe. I want her to find my godson, the only son of... Dun-dun-dun! Rick Flag. So again, we now find out how that little boy that was just kidnapped is tied into the Suicide Squad and why it's appearing in the Suicide Squad book. When, again, Jeb Stuart's not a big player in the Suicide Squad. We don't know who this family is. We now find out that apparently that little boy is the son of Rick Flag. And again, another great story. It ends with our next issue box, our 50th issue, double size, the return of old friends, both living and dead, and the unveiling of the true identity of one of the squad's greatest foes. Debt of honor. Dun, dun, dun. Oh, sorry. But again, so great story. I loved it. Thought it was a fantastic two-part story of Barbara trying to come to grips and come to terms with what happened to her all those many years ago back in The Killing Joke. Bringing in the new thinker too. A new asset for Amanda to use in the team. Fantastic. But that's it for this issue. Next month is a double-sized 50th issue. It looks like it's called The Legacy of Rick Flag. So we will see what happens then. But in the meantime, make sure to let me know what you think. Send me an email to head@headspeaks.com. Right now, my Headcast network is still down. I'm still working on trying to see if I get that back up. I don't want to pay a lot of money because, again, it's just for my podcasting, which I don't make any money on, really. So I'm working on that. But right now, you can email me to head@headspeaks.com. Check out the Facebook group, facebook.com/groups/headcastnetwork. Again, I do have my toll-free number, or not toll-free, I'm sorry. I do have my phone number you can call if you want to call and leave a message on the Headcast voicemail line. That number is 1-559-500-3182. Call and leave a message. Let me know what you think about this episode, about these issues, about Suicide Squad in general. And until next month, I guess that's going to do it. Squad mates, dismissed.
Thank you for listening to another great episode of Task Force X. I can also be found rambling on my main headcast of Head Speaks, where I rant and rave about movies, comics, geek stuff, and whatever is bugging me.
Mate, you just out crazy the Joker.
Well, I tried, Boomer, but anyways, my home on the internet is at headspeaks.com. H-E-A-D-S-P-E-A-K-S.com. Links to my blog, which contain follow-up information to this and every Headcast, can be found there. Both Task Force X and Headspeaks are on iTunes, Stitcher Radio, and at headspeaks.com under Headcasts. Please feel free to email me any questions, comments, or concerns to taskforcex@headspeaks.com. And if you want to record a message, you can send it to me at taskforcex@headspeaks.com, and I'll play it on the air. I'm also on Facebook at Task Force X, and also on Google Plus, you can look for Task Force X under People and Pages. All titles and characters discussed are owned and copyrighted by DC Comics. I claim no ownership to the Suicide Squad, Checkmate, or Task Force X. I'm just a big fan wanting to spread the Task Force X love with everyone else. DC Comics can be found on the web at dccomics.com. Be sure to visit your local comic shop and look for Suicide Squad and Checkmate Comics. And while you're there, see what else they have that may interest you.
Mother.
Well, make sure you join us here next time for another fun-filled podcast from your friendly neighborhood, Brotherhead. In the meantime, I'll see you in the funny pages.